fascinating figure, gazing west into the sunset, guarding this gargantuan stone temple structure pointing to the heavens. And there's just something see some beautiful landscapes, such as the aerial view of the Nile near Luxor. A view of the magnificent cliffs of Sharm el-Sheikh. Southernmost area of the Nile River as the Upper Nile, because its course that it takes north from the high terrain of Central Africa down all the way to the Delta. South Mediterranean. So, therefore, the downstream area of the Nile flow is going to be called Lower Egypt. Upper Egypt. Lower Egypt. So, let's begin with this beautiful satellite. Sisters in structures. The vast, the monumental, the gargantuan. The absolutely mystifyingly large structures of the pyramids, temples, and various other architectures they developed over the course of thousands of years. Alright, let's continue on to the journey into the past. About 6,000 years into the past, as a matter of fact. And I love the juxtaposition of current technology. Maybe 50, 100 years old. Buildings, cars, light posts, light poles, boats, with outboard engines. And these ridiculously old, ancient, right along the ancient river that has probably seen so much history, so many experiences. Events, historic, biblical events, literally. We have the rich, fertile grounds, overshadowed by the arid hills, sandy hills in the background. And you know, no one really likes sand. It's coarse, rough, and irritating. If you got that reference, I love you guys. Okay, so to get into some meat, I love the emergence of this mysteriously powerful and grandiose and creative spiritual civilization. It's such a mystery. Also have quite a bit of evidence and artifacts that can point us in the right direction. So, before 1998, the oldest artifact had been dated to 3000 BC, 5000 years ago. Then, the Egyptologist, Mr. Dreyer, from the German Institute of Cairo, discovered two bone tablets. Civilization lasting for 3,000 years. Ancient Rome only lasted maybe 1,000 at most, if you really, really stretch it out. And these people lasted for 3,000 years, roughly intact. The same religion and the same architecture and writings, hieroglyphs. Lost, and the pagan, non-Christian cults were banned. That's why we're here. We're here to find out as much as we can. The area of ancient Egypt had been inhabited from the prehistoric period and the post-glacial era. Civilization. One of these was the upper or southern valley of Egypt, of the Nile rather, extending to the south of Africa. And the second, of course, was eastern Turkey and Afghanistan, known as Mesopotamia, extending as far as the Indus River. First, Neolithic agricultural communities settled in the upper valley. Around 8,000 years ago. These cultures defined as pre-dynastic enjoyed a rapid organizational, social, and technological development before the start of the dynastic epoch inaugurated with the first historical pharaoh, Menes. Tradition has it unified the country that had hitherto been divided into northern and southern states. And I think it's worth pointing out that the technological metallurgy development was a long process of trial and error, discovering how hot certain metals needed to be heated before they could fuse together with other metals and fused in an exact, sometimes to a nearly 1/100 proportions or a percent. Exactly right, into alloys that these civilizations were able to discover, create, and of course fight with. So, I think it's so fascinating. I'd like to actually do an episode, a better one. I did one about 3 years ago. It's probably one of my first episodes, actually, regarding the series The Ascent of Man. It's similar to Cosmos, and it predates Carl Sagan's Cosmos by about 10 years or so in the 70s. And for many, many months in a row, I fell asleep to that series. It's so rich, dense with information about really just the ascent of mankind and our wonderful ability, our literally wonderful ability to have mastered the process of creating a samurai sword, which is artfully, skillfully crafted by folding metal, reheating it, pounding it out, and folding it back on itself. I think 30 some odd times, 32 times even, which eventually, if you do that math, to extract the gold, you sublimate it, I believe it's called. And I feel like this civilization is the sublimation, which I think is actually a term Nietzsche used a lot. It's like kind of the, we're in some vague prehistoric state, disbanded tribes and warring neighbors in minor nations, and then this man, meanies, traditionally unifying the northern and southern areas of the Nile, creating one vast empire along this magnificently historically important river. And I'm rambling on way too much and not showing you enough pictures. But I'm just so jazzed about this book. Yes, I just said jazzed. Because I'm a fusion of many things, and a nerd is certainly one of those. I feel like Joe Pera right now, the way I'm talking, and I love it. The reality was rather more complex. Archaeological finds testify to the existence of a nameless king known as the Scorpion King, after the figure appearing on a ceremonial mace, who reigned at the end of the pre-dynastic period between 3150 and 3050 BC before Christ. Many Egyptologists placed Scorpion King in the so-called Dynasty Zero, making it the original dynasty, really, along with Narmer, perhaps the father of Menes. And the Museum of Cairo contains the photo of Narmer palette. Enjoy that. Now, briefly want to apologize if my hand looks like it was in an arm wrestling match with several cats at once. It was simply a foolish moment where I didn't use garden gloves when I was, or long sleeves. It's actually all the way up my arm. Tearing out some sawgrass type plants that were continually making small. It's like death by a thousand cuts. And hopefully my channel doesn't suffer death by a thousand cuts. Just in case you were wondering if I was ridiculously unsuccessful at a suicide. Anyways, the third dynasty opened with the pharaoh of Sanakht, or Nebka, who is less well known than his presumed brother Djoser, the builder of the steps. social, cultural, and artistic organization, which really is phenomenal when you think about it. The pharaoh was at the top of the hierarchical pyramid, with the sacerdotal class-wielding great political power. Step lower. Sophistication of the incorporation of this bird behind the brain of this pharaoh. His brain was, I guess it doesn't say who it is, but if anybody is interested in the more spiritual explorations and really kind of all the fringe yet very reputable research done into the spiritual, the very extremely sophisticated spiritual elements of these pyramid oriented pharaohs. I would highly recommend checking out John Anthony West, the recently deceased, just a month or two ago, actually. Sadly enough, John Anthony West and Robert Shock's awesome little series called Magical Egypt. It used to be on YouTube, they might still have first episode up, but it's just a very compelling look at what exactly might have been the motive for all of the grandiose architecture. I think the importance of this bird, the significance of it, is that it's a hawk. Type of hawk, I think, but regardless, it's a bird who are known to have very excellent vision, and what better skill to refine as a pharaoh, a head of a hierarchy, than to have a vision and awareness and all the other synonyms and symbols that might conjure up in your head. It's behind his brain, so clearly it's wrapping its wings around him, helping him direct his vision, and maybe perhaps keep his head straight on the straight and narrow, keep his intentions true and honest. And I think I love little tidbits like that this exact figure is talked about for 5 or 10 minutes by John Anthony West in one of his episodes. So, continue on with the beginning of the... Okay, here we go. Let's 64 BC. That central power was reinforced at the expense of the sacerdotal class. The capital was moved, and work began. I really wanted to touch upon the African origins, the African involvement. Suppressing them. That would have been, well, that would have looked really bad, wouldn't it have? So, I think there was active political and existential reasons for them to suppress and whitewash, as you will. So I think it's very cool to think that, you know, Egypt, which we all revere and are so in awe of, fact was, there's very much an African, first and foremost, civilization. So it says the old dynasty conquered Nubia with its rich deposits of gold in the Middle Kingdom. Was a civil and military architecture, and in fact, literature, above all. The texts from this epic, in fact, were copied by the successive generations of the Egyptians themselves, referred to this as a golden. I think. at the same time, well, let's find out, but I have a feeling that the original Pyramid of Giza, the most revered and impressive architecturally pyramid, was built before this pyramid, this era, and I don't think was ever matched again. So it's like there is a refinement in culture, and perhaps a lessening of impetus to create grand structures like that, and call forth that much, probably slave labor and resources to build something that grand since then. But I think overall there was an evolution towards an increased level of sophistication in literature, metallurgy, architecture, and jewelry. Says the applied sciences also found fertile terrain in the Middle Kingdom. Specialists, medical, mathematical, and veterinary treatises were written. You can only imagine how many cats were saved due to that revelation, the innovation in medical technology. The construction of pyramids revived, albeit on a smaller scale. The largest temple of all time, mentioned by Herodotus in Book 2 of his history as the Labyrinth, was also built. So there you go. They shifted their perspective from large to more elaborate. Labyrinths, temples. The 12th dynasty drew to a close with the pharaoh Amenemhat IV and Queen Sebek Nefru. From this point, the historical reconstruction becomes fragmentary. This next part I was reading earlier, and actually I made a video earlier, but I scrapped it because it was hopefully worse than this one, but it was the context in which the Semitic or Jewish or Hyksos, meaning heads of foreign countries, because you always hear is that the Jews were enslaved by the Egyptians, and Moses, their savior, their prophet, their leader, their king, was able to free them and lead them to the promised land, almost, after 40 years of wandering in the Sinai Desert. So, and just on this channel, because I'm talking about seemingly controversial stuff, such as people with a darker skin tone than me, people with a different religious background than I, although not very different, I don't want to get it twisted. Although I can't imagine anyone who has watched even one of my other videos would ever think I'm racist or religiously intolerant, specifically anti-Jewish or anti-Semitic, perhaps even anti-Hyksos. So, no, I hope you guys recognize that I am purely very much enthused by learning about his transition called the Second Intermediate Period that perhaps as a result around. precisely who the sea peoples actually are or where they come from. Another fascinating mystery, but so we have, let's see, the 19th dynasty with the reigns of the great pharaohs who left testimony to their power in the form of monumental works. Seti the First, Ramses the Second, and Merneptah. The period also saw the war with the Hittites and the Battle of Kadesh, as well as the biblical exodus of the Jews under the leadership of Moses. So, that's apparently 1000 BC. And the Hyksos, the old ancient Jews, were dominating in, let's see, roughly 700 years before. So, if you can imagine, for 250 years, Jews were dominating Egyptian culture. And no doubt there was a lot of fusion and assimilation of Egyptian and Jewish elements into both religions. We all know how much religion can change over the course of even a few hundred years. So, you can only imagine after 700 years, 250 of which the Jews, the Hyksos, the Semites dominated, then were finally overthrown as all rules tend to be. And that leaves us with roughly 400 years, 450 years, where I'm sure the remaining Jews were, of course, enslaved. Until Moses was their mole. He was their inside man, and he was able to lead a mass exodus, bit of biblical proportions nonetheless. You can imagine I just raised my eyebrows there. But yeah, so it's cool to get the whole context of it all, I think. Like it too. Alright. Well, you know what? It's getting late, and this was way, way longer than I intended it to be. Although I love giving you guys long, very long episodes, it just takes so much effort, and I have very little time. But I do want to thank you all for contributing what you do to the channel. It's whether it's actual money, whether it's just love, whether it's comments, good critical feedback. It's overall very positive and super encouraging to hear from you guys. So I just really genuinely want to thank everybody out there. You're really the backbone of this channel, whether you know it or not, so it's so, so awesome to be able to connect and share my fascination and love of history and science and past and future speculation with the Kardashev scale and the Fermi paradox that you guys love, and I also love, actually have a couple things, ideas I'm working on for you, which hopefully are a little less rambly and more right to the point. Carl Jung's Aeon, in which he he tries to ground the origin of our consciousness, very much incorporating Egyptian mythology. In a emergence and transition from animal to man and ape to man. More succinctly, I don't know, you can imagine, like, just imagine all the history, all the, just in the last, those 700 years where the Jews came in, conquered many parts of Egypt, ruled for almost 300 years, were overthrown. Ties in.